Hello, dear fans, friends, and subscribers of Cricket Happenings. Your host Ram is welcoming you to your Sunday edition of the Cricket Happening Show. And on this show, it is going to be three matches. So definitely, you can't expect me to really go into greater detail on any of those. But first, let me start off with the synopsis. First, I'll speak about the second day's play in the match between New Zealand and India. And as I said yesterday, it was very, very essential that New Zealand actually got the two wickets of Ajinkya Rahane and Virat Kohli when the partnership was going strong. But one can say what I would like to say, I'm afraid that it didn't happen, and New Zealand were made to toil for three sessions without a single wicket of the Indians, as this particular partnership between Virat Kohli and Ajinkya Rahane put on a record 365 runs for the fourth wicket, and that is a record. That's a record as far as India are concerned. This is the highest ever partnership that they have for the fourth wicket, with Virat Kohli getting on to a double century, which was his test best score. As you remember, he made 200 against the West Indies, and today he got 200 odd runs, which I'll be talking about. And Ajinkya Rahane went on to miss his double century and also notched up his highest test best score of 188 runs, as the New Zealand bowlers were kept in the park for quite a long time, and India declaring the innings closed at 557 for 5. And Virat Kohli is also the first Indian captain to have scored two double centuries as the captain of the Indian team. So it's a proud achievement for Virat Kohli, no doubt about it. So, and after that, in the 9 overs that were left for New Zealand to bat, the New Zealand batsmen played in an aggressive vein to score 37 runs out of it, which I'll be talking about. And the second match which I'm going to talk about is the Australia versus South Africa. I was telling you that it's a matter of Australia going on and salvaging something, but let me tell you today, absolutely no excuses, because South Africa rested all their top names: Dale Steyn, Kagiso Rabada, Imran Tahir, and also I think there was one more batsman who was rested. So they rested all the key players, and one would have expected Australia to pull this off, but the reverse happened. In fact, South Africa showed what is the depth that they have in their bowling, basically the reserve talent I'm talking about, and Kyle Abbott was the one who took full advantage of a wicket in this one-day series, that for the first time we saw there was some movement available, and with that appreciable movement that was there, Kyle Abbott was the one who made good use of it with a four-wicket bag. And also Tabrez Shamsi was given an opportunity here, picked up three wickets with his wrist spin, and they sunk the Aussies for 167, and in fact scored the required runs with 87 balls to spare. So South Africa now cleanly, definitely eyeing a whitewash of the Aussies, and one probably feels, or as per records it says, that Australia have never been thrashed 5-0 in an ODI series. Can South Africa do it to them in the fifth one-day international? And as far as the other match is concerned, the England and Bangladesh match, there was some real needle going on when Joss Butler was out. But let me tell you, Bangladesh have really livened up the series here on a Sunday, giving their fans a lot of things to cheer about on Sunday, when actually they had the better of England. As this time, Bangladesh, even though they didn't put up a very big score on the board, what was more important was Mashrafe Mortaza, the captain of the Bangladesh team, leading by example, not only with the bat, when he came in when Bangladesh were in trouble, by hitting a very, very quick 44 of 29 deliveries, and then getting on to pack four England wickets back into the pavilion pretty quickly to reduce them to nothing at one stage. And in the final analysis, it was Taskin Ahmed who took the stuffing out of the English middle order, and it was all over, as the Bangladesh team actually had a victory by, I think, I'm just trying to see the margin, as far as the margin was 34 run margin. And now the final match of the ODI series, which is the decider coming up on Wednesday, should be a real beauty. And definitely when Josh Butler was out, there was a lot of things. In fact, even after the Bangladesh and England players were at real against each other, one could say, after Josh Butler's dismissal, when Josh Butler actually he probably felt that something was he was given out on a review, and when the Bangladesh roar was very very big, it probably riled Josh Butler, and Josh Butler said a few things, probably heard a few things being said about him by the Bangladeshi players. He looked back, he charged at them, and then it required the umpire's intervention there. And even after the handshakes were over, I'm told there was still some needle going on between both the teams. Well, dear fans and subscribers, so that is as far as the synopsis are concerned of these three particular matches. And now we dive into not in the details, but we dive into what really happened. As I said, for as far as India is concerned, it was all about Virat Kohli and Ajinkya Rahane. Virat Kohli and Ajinkya Rahane striding like a colossus, one could say, as India actually, they helped them actually end up with a colossal score of 557 for 5 declared. In fact, Kohli and Rahane keeping the Kiwis on the pitch for all three sessions without a single wicket, and that could be really, really frustrating for the opposition, no doubt about it. And Virat Kohli continued his in his same way, and if you look at his innings of 211, which was his second double century, it had only 20 boundaries, but he always kept the scoreboard busy, never allowed the bowlers to settle in. Again, it was the same thing, the same story as to what happened yesterday when he was actually stroking the ball freely and smoothly, and that's what precisely was happening at the and he was also bisecting the gaps very well. And today he played some lovely strokes down the ground. As far as Ajinkya Rahane was concerned, again we saw that Ajinkya Rahane was put to the test here with some bouncers. The short stuff once again worried him, but definitely he got over that slowly but surely. But definitely he was tested with some unpredictable bounce there from the pace bowlers, as Ajinkya Rahane slowly but surely settled in, and slowly Virat Kohli and Rahane really made New Zealand toil on the day, on a very hot and humid day here in Indore. And let me tell you the pitch yesterday, as I said, there were a lot of cracks on it, but today one definitely did not see the cracks. I was talking to you about the cracks widening, but one did not see that, and there were even the footmarks, I would say, didn't really help there. And we saw some turn, no doubt about it, but again it was slow turn. And Virat Kohli and Ajinkya Rahane, as I said, Ajinkya Rahane using his spin, using his feet very adeptly when the spinners were bowling. And Ajinkya Rahane also played some beautiful strokes. I mean, certain strokes he was absolutely matching Kohli with his style of stroke play, as Virat Kohli and Rahane put up the highest ever partnership for the fourth wicket by India in Test cricket, as they added 365 runs for the fourth wicket before it was Kohli who was gone when in the final session. LBW bowled Patel for 211 with 20 boundaries. Ajinkya Rahane missed upon a century. He was caught by Watling of the bowling of bowl for 188 with 18 fours and 4 sixes. And the license was given to Rohit Sharma and Ravindra Jadeja to get as many runs as possible by Virat Kohli so that he could apply the declaration. That's what precisely happened, as Rohit Sharma went on to slam 51 with 3 fours and 2 sixes. He was unbeaten on 51. Jadeja was unbeaten on 17 with 1 boundary. India declaring the innings closed 557 for 5. As far as the bowling was concerned, I'm not going to go into much of the details here. Most of the bowlers, the frontline bowlers, were made to leak 100 runs. 213 bowled, none for 127. Matt Henry today looked a bit awry in his line. He never could hit his straps. Jeetan Patel 2 for 120. Impress Santon 1 for 137. Nisham 1 for 53. As far as New Zealand were concerned, they were given 9 overs to survive. And in the 9 overs, I thought they played in a bit of an attacking vein, one could say, as New Zealand actually closed the day at 28 for no loss. with Martin Guptill, the opener, for the first time looking a bit confident on 17 with 2 fours and 1 6, and Tom Latham was not out on 6, 28 for no loss, Shami none for 5, Umesh Yadav none for 7, Ashwin none for 9, and Jadeja none for 2. I'm not going to go into those details, as I said, I still have 2 matches to cover. So now we head on to the next match. We just said this is the match which one was waiting for, to see whether Australia could salvage something. But look at what happened. It was Australia versus South Africa, which was played at St. George's Park in Port Elizabeth. The toss was won by Australia, and Australia decided that they will bat first. They batted first, and probably they were under the impression that the pitch might play in the same vein as a good batting beauty, but it was not to be. In fact, as I said, South Africa had rested off their big names there. As I said, there's no Kagiso Rabada, no Imantahe, no Dale Steyn, and yet Australia lost this particular match. So even one could not even say that Australia having Australia are crippled, because this was a match-to-match match-to-match as far as the teams were concerned, and it was South Africa who were the victors by 6 wickets. So looking at that, Kyle Abbott was the one who started doing the damage. First he picked up the wicket of Aaron Finch with a beauty, I would say. The ball that cut back in sharply plucked his off stump. He was gone for 2 of 3 balls. David Warner was absolutely surprised by the pace and bounce generated by Kyle Abbott, as the ball actually nipped in and David Warner was a goner. It went on to go between his bat and pad gap and nip off the off bail. So he was gone, and after that we saw Shamsi get into the act. Tabrez Shamsi, the wrist spinner, actually forced Stephen Smith on his forward prod, and Stephen Smith was at just LBW with the ball holding its line. He was gone for 21 of 36 W's, 2 fours. Pretorius got through Bailey, got him LBW for 1, and then we also said Travis Saint inside edge, trying to play off the inside edge. He actually couldn't get the bat onto that. He was gone LBW bowled Shamsi for naught, and Australia were in deep trouble at 49 for 5 at one stage. And then only thanks to Mitchell Marsh, who made 50 of 72 balls, 5 fours and 1 6, and Matthew Wade going on to make 52 of 58 dealt with 5 fours and 2 sixes, and playing in a real attacking vein, and also getting into a sort of a real tangle with Tabrez Shamsi there. And the umpires had to intervene over there, with words being exchanged, and finally things came to a halt. But it was the Aussie and the Australians were absolutely riled at the time, one could say. Hastings was out for 4, Zampa was out for 5, Tremaine played a good knock, I would say, not out on 28 Davis, 2 fours and 1 6, and 167. The Aussies were sunk by the South Africans to 167 all out. The bowling, Kyle Abbott, 8 overs, no maiden, 40 runs and 4 wickets bowled superbly, one thought. And the other bowler was Tabrez Shamsi, not only showing economy, also picking up 10 overs, 1 maiden, 3 for 36. Pretorius, 7 overs, 1 maiden, 1 for 33. Phil Cavallo, 5 overs, none for 28, also bowled well. Fungiso also getting the last 2 wickets to bring in a real end to this Aussie innings. 4.4 overs, no maiden, 2 for 17. Dumini, 2 overs, no maiden, none for 13. So now it was the time for the South Africans to go and chase this particular total, just set by the Aussies. They did not have it right altogether, one could say, because they lost Hashim Amla pretty early in the piece. In fact, Tremaine bowled a very, very good opening spell for the Aussies. Today he was impressive. He actually nipped up the wickets of Hashim Amla, LBW for 4, and he also picked up the wicket of Quinton de Kock, who went on to pull a ball caught by Zampa of the bowling of Tremaine for 18 of 14 deliveries, 3 fours. And then it was Duplessis was dropped by Zampa, a real sitter, one could say, a skier, which Zampa dropped, and it was Duplessis who actually scored a good knock to make 69, profited from the clap, 69 of 87 deliveries, 8 fours. Dumini was victim of Zampa for 25, and then finally it was really Rozu and Bahardin taking them to victory. Really Rozu was not out on 33, 45 deliveries, 5 fours, and Bahardin was not out on 12, 14 deliveries, 1 four, 168 for 4. South Africa winning the match by 6 wickets, and now taking a 4-0 lead, and definitely eyeing a whitewash of the Aussies, which probably has never happened. There's no team has actually beaten, probably, or South Africa has never beaten the Aussies in a one-day international series final. So probably is that going to happen when the final ODI would be played. Tremaine was impressive today, 10 overs, no made in 248. Ball in 10 overs, 2 minutes, none for 36. Also bowled a good line. Hastings continued to unimpress, 4 overs, none for 27. Adam Zampa, 6.3 overs, no made in 1 for 32. And Mitchell Marsh, 5 overs, 1 for 22. Kyle Abbott of the South Africa was named man of the match. Now, very quickly, we are heading towards Bangladesh, where England and Bangladesh fought a match which had a lot of needle towards the end, one could say. As England toured of Bangladesh was the England who actually won the toss, and they decided that they will put Bangladesh into bat. And Bangladesh, well, their start was not good. They were in some real trouble. Wokes had picked up the wicket of Tamim Iqbal for 14 and Imrul Case for 11. And then Sabir Rahman was a goner, bowled by Jake Ball for 3. And after that, it was Mahmoodullah who played a very good knock. I saw a very calm and composed knock of 75 of 88 deliveries with 6 fours. Mushfiqur Rahim was out for 21. And Shakib Lazman was bowled, caught by Butler of the bowling of Stokes for 3. And then Mossadegh Hussain contributing 29 of 49 deliveries with 4 fours. And suddenly we saw this Bangladesh, they started losing wickets at regular intervals, and they were in some real bother, one could say, as they were reduced to 169 for 7 by the 42nd over. But the man in the middle, it was Mashrafe Mortaza, the captain. He single-handedly started, he spanked Moeen Ali for 2 sixes. Then he also put, I thought it was David Willey who was put over the long on fence for a 6. And Mashrafe Mortaza really went on slogging in a merry way. Got some good company from Nasir Hussain in a good partnership, which enabled the Bangladeshis to end up with a respectable 238 for 8 of the 50 overs. Mashrafe Mortaza was run out for 44 of 29 deliveries, 2 fours and 3 sixes. Nasir Hussain was not out on 27 as many balls with 2 fours. Shafiul Islam was not out on 238 for 8. Was what Bangladesh put up on the board. And as far as the bowling was concerned from the Englishmen, Wokes had 9 overs, 2 for 40. Willey, I thought, bowled well. Still, 8 overs, none for 36. Adil Rashid got 2 for 53 of his 10. Jake Ball, 2 for 44, was costly. Stokes, 6 overs, 1 for 22, was good. Moeen Ali, 9 overs, none for 39. Now, as far as the England were concerned, they were given a target of 239 runs to win the match, and they finished 34 runs short. The story goes like this. It was Mashrafe Mortaza who put them on the back foot right away. First, he picked up the wicket of Jason Roy, who was LBW. In fact, Vince was the first to go. Vince normally likes to drive the ball very well through the offside, but he was caught by Mossadegh Hussain for 5 of 10 balls with 1-4. Later, Mashrafe Mortaza went on to dismiss the other opener, Jason Roy, with a ball that nipped in, and LBW ball Mashrafe Mortaza for 13 of 21 deliveries. And then the heroes, Ben Duckett, who did a wonderful job in the previous one day international, was a goner. He was clean bowled. He was bowled through the gate by Shakib Al Hassan for naught. And Ben Stokes was the other one that was a big wicket, as Mashrafe Mortaza got a big inducker, which Ben Stokes actually lost his stumps. He was gone for naught, and England were in real trouble at that stage, with Mashrafe Mortaza having taken 3 wickets, and England were reeling at 26 for 4 in the 10th over. Now it was the turn for Jonathan Bairstow. There were 2 new batsmen in the middle, Jonathan Bairstow and the captain Butler, and they, I would say, resuscitated things for the Englishmen as they slowly started taking the score forward, as they added a very good 75 runs for the 5th wicket. So a recovery was made of sorts over there, and things were going on, but Taskeen Ahmed came into the middle and really removed the stuffing out of the England innings. As what he did is he picked up the wicket of Jonathan Bairstow by getting him caught by Mushfiqur Rahim for 53 deliveries, 1-4, and then he also castled Joss Butler. Joss Butler was making batting looking pretty easy. He was going at a runner ball stuff of 57 of as many balls with 7 fours before Taskeen Ahmed had him LBW, and also Taskeen Ahmed went on to pick up the wicket of Chris Wokes for 7, and suddenly once again Bangladesh were in the game there, as 132 for 8 in the 30th over, but they still had Moeen Ali and Adil Rashid at the crease. Moeen Ali was a goner. He was the victim of Nasir Hussain, and then we saw, and as I told you, Joss Butler, when he was out, there was a bit of needle going on because of the uproar that happened. Adil Rashid was left on 33 not out. Jake Ball tried his best to club 28 of 22 deliveries, 5 fours, and David Willey was LBW Mossadegh Hussain. Rashid was not on 33, 44 balls, 1-4, 1-6, and that it was Bangladesh actually leveling the series in a wonderful manner as they won the match by 34 runs against England, and now the decider, which is coming up on Wednesday, should be a real beauty. As far as the bowling was concerned from the Bangladeshis, Shakib Hasan, 9 overs, no maiden, 1 for 50, bowled well, I thought. Mashrafe Mortaza putting up an all-round performance to pick up the Man of the Match award. 8.4 overs, no maiden, 29 runs and 4 wickets. Splendid bowling from the captain of the Bangladeshi team. Shafiul Islam, 8 overs, 9 for 37. Taskin Hamid did a wonderful job in the middle, picking up 3 wickets for 47, which was the turning point to me. Nasir Zain, 10 overs, 1 for 29. Bowled his quota pretty well. Mossad Hussain, 1 overs, 1 for 5. And Mashrafe Mortaza, the captain of Bangladesh team, taking the Man of the Match award. And as I said, on Wednesday, the deciding third one-day international, which is coming up between England and Bangladesh, should be a real beauty. Well, dear fans and subscribers, thanks for your immense patience in watching this cricket show. And I'll be back with you, dear folks, tomorrow on my next cricket happening show. Till such time that happens, this is your host, Ram, signing off for the day.